So in the two examples that we just looked at, there was a vast space of inputs, and some small part of that constituted the actual input domain for the software under test. And what happened was, when we generated invalid inputs, which is extremely easy to do, they were executing a boring part of the software under test and getting mapped to input rejection errors. And those rejections of invalid input were basically forcing us to generate another value and submit it and see what happens. So what's going to happen is the random testing loop is going to spend a lot of time spinning. That is to say, stressing on only a small part of the software under test. But there's actually something different that can happen that's much worse than that. So the other thing that can happen is the input isn't rejected. And the reason that an invalid input might not be rejected is that the software under test fails to contain sufficient validity checking logic in order to distinguish valid inputs from invalid inputs. And so what we get now is something potentially much worse. We get strange misbehavior, crashes, or something else very bad. And the problem is that when we get misbehavior, crashes, and other bad behavior from the software under test, these behaviors, instead of being rejected by the software under test and letting our random testing loop proceed, these behaviors look like bugs. So normally if we crash the software under test, this is something that we have to track down manually, and now we're taking a developer's time. And once we start taking humans' time, what we're essentially doing is mounting a denial of service attack on whoever's processing bugs that come out of the random testing loop. After looking at about 10 bugs that are caused by invalid inputs to the software under test, the person who's looking at that input is going to get tired of it and isn't going to look at them anymore. And now we have a problem. Now we have a random testing loop producing no actionable output. And so our random testing effort is basically failing. And so let's talk a little bit about why software under test would lack a validity checker. Well, as we saw, I believe in Unit 1, internal interfaces, that is to say, interfaces within a product and interfaces that don't span trust boundaries, often lack full validity checking. And they do that for performance reasons, for code maintainability reasons, basically because we have to trust somebody sometime, otherwise we can't get any software written. Another reason is there exists software for which it's impossible to construct a validity checker. And so earlier in this unit, I was talking about the example of using CSmith, that is to say, my random test generator that generates C programs for testing compilers. And it turns out that C compilers don't contain a good validity checker for C. And the reasons for that are kind of involved, but the quick answer is that if you have a C program, it's undecidable whether that program dereferences a null pointer, access an out-of-bounds array element, or do something else that violates the rules of C. So compilers do quite a lot of validity checking. That is to say, they look for syntactically invalid C. What they fail to do is check for the dynamic validity properties that are required for certain kinds of miscompilation bugs. So in summary, the input validity problem bites us as a performance problem almost every time we write a random tester. It bites us in a much more serious way when we have software under test that lacks a reliable validity checker.